Chant Om three times. विष्णु गुरुर्देव महेश्वर गुरुर्साक्षात् परब्रह्म तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः। गुरवे सर्वलोकानां पिशचे भवरोगिणः निधये सर्वविद्यानां दक्षिणामूर्तये नमः। ॐ नमः प्रणवार्थाय शुद्धज्ञानैकमूर्तये निर्मलाय प्रशान्ताय दक्षिणामूर्तये नमः। हरिः ओम्। See, we have this gross world and there is a subtle world. So what happens in the gross world is managed by what is in the subtle world. Say for example, what makes your smartphone work? What are the, how does the functions of the smartphone, what does it work through?
Operating system.
Yeah, it works through your apps. If there are no apps, then you can't do anything. There you got an app for WhatsApp, you got an app for calling, you got an app for everything, yeah? So the function, the gross function to happen, you need to have this app in the background. It should be working in the background, only then the function will happen, yeah? In the same way, in this world, there are a lot of subtle energies which make particular things happen. And these are called as devatas. They are just different aspects of the same Brahman consciousness, different energies which are there. Like there is one particular energy which is responsible for your digestion, one is responsible for your intelligence, one is responsible for your wealth, one is responsible for your talents. Yeah. And what is the feed for these devatas is called mantras. The world is under the hand of the devatas and devatas under the influence of mantras. Okay, it's very interesting. So last time we said that, you know, there are the prakriti which in which we live, the gross world is made up of five elements. And the five elements exhibit three qualities. So among these five elements, you got from earth to the space. And we are nothing but a combination of these elements in different proportions. Yeah? So, when the earth element is in balance, it provides you the quality of steadiness and strength. Stability comes from the earth element. Water element gives you flexibility. Fire element brings enthusiasm and passion, interest in life. The air element brings joyfulness, playfulness, and the space element brings you contentment and peace. Now, the first four elements, they can get out of sync very easily if you don't live life the natural way. So when the earth element goes out of sync, the same stability can manifest as heaviness and laziness, lethargy. The flexibility of water element can manifest as craving. The passion and enthusiasm of fire element can manifest as greed, jealousy, obsession. And the playfulness of the air element can manifest as restlessness. The space element can never go out of sync because everything is contained in space. So, use space to set right other elements. In the same way, the senses is related to the five elements. The sense of smell is related to the earth element, taste to the water element, eyes, sight to the fire element, touch to the air element, and sound to the space element. So, sound and space are related. And this is the scientific basis behind the use of mantras. The mantras are nothing but sounds. So, use the space element in a different form, which is like a sound, to correct the imbalances in the other four elements. And when the imbalances are corrected, you are in sync with nature. That is when thing happens how nature has determined it. Okay? So, different mantras have got different effects. So, if you have noticed this, we have given this example before. Have you seen how the pujaris are there in the Shiva temple? Have you seen, noticed how they are? Have I discussed this before with you?
No.
No? Okay, this is very interesting. Have you seen how the priests are there in the Shiva temple? Have you noticed them? So, they are usually thin. Yeah? And they will be waiting, be wearing a cotton dhoti or something. Usually, they won't have anything on the top also. Yeah? Have you seen? Yeah? Have you seen how the priests are in Vishnu temple? Yeah, they usually got a big paunch, they are quite well built. They have got all silk clothes, they have got 10 rings in their 10 fingers, they have got golden necklace. Have you seen this? Why is it like this? Because that particular mantras which you chant brings that particular vibrations in your life. So, Vishnu stands for prosperity. If you are more devoted to Vishnu, you get lot of prosperity. But prosperity also brings the problems that comes with prosperity. But when you are more engaged in the Shiva consciousness, you brings dispassion, vairagya comes to you. So, all those things don't matter. So, the mantras have their own subtle effect. If you keep on engaging in a particular mantra, that particular aspect of you starts evolving. So, these are not religious sounds, these are scientific sounds. Especially Sanskrit is an extremely scientific language. Have you ever tried the Sanskrit alphabets?
Yeah.
With awareness? Okay. If you see, you know the A, I, E and all?
Yeah.
You know where A starts from? Okay, let's do it now. So, you will get to know. Okay. A, A.
A,
A. It comes from here. Okay.
Yeah.
E,
E.
U,
U.
U,
U.
Ru. See, Ru, the tongue and touching the palate. Okay, Ru. Okay, so it's come from here till here. A, A, I, the tongue is moving forwards. Yeah? O, O, Au, now the lips are coming. Aha. Do you see? It starts from the vocal cords and ends at the lips. So it is not a language which has been concocted. It is not a random language, it is a very scientific language. It has evolved as the creation has evolved. So, the sounds are, which are delivered in Sanskrit, they are not randomly placed things. They are given by people who at their height of meditativeness, they discovered this and they gave it to us. They did not think and write this down like a formula. It just came to them in that state and it was given to them. So, like this, there are a few mantras which are very basic, which are very powerful. Say, for example, Om Namah Shivaya. So, the Namah Shivaya represents the five elements. So, when you chant Om Namah Shivaya, it is a very powerful mantra. The five elements get synced on its own. Okay. Now, Vasudeva. Vasu means prana. Vasu means prana. Vasudeva is the master of prana. So, when you chant Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya, what happens? The prana in you starts rising. Narayana. Nara means nervous system. Narayana is one who has mastered the nervous system. So when you chant the Narayana Suktam or the Om Namo Narayanaya, what happens? The ability to win over your senses, ability to be master over your sensory nervous system becomes stronger. Because like this, there are many, many, many mantras. So for example, the Medha Suktam or the Gayatri Mantra, they sharpen your intellect. Okay, see, after a particular age, probably 21 years or so, your brain does not grow. It starts to degrow. Means everything which is there starts slowly, slowly degenerating. The peculiarity of the brain is that in every part of the body, if something dies, it regenerates. In the brain, it does not. Once it is gone, it is gone. They have found that Gayatri Mantra stops that. As long as you are chanting it regularly, that process does not start at all. That is why it keeps your intellect very sharp. That is why, you know, dhiyo yo na prachodayat. Keep my intellect sharp and keep it stimulated all the time. So these are all very scientific. But unfortunately, as we grew up and learned the Western knowledge, we thought we are all superstitions. So we gave up our own culture without understanding the background through which these were all created. So it's very important that we keep in touch with these things. So every week we'll do a few chants. Okay, we'll do a few minutes of chants, especially those which we, and you observe what happens. It's just like a pranayama. Okay, so we'll do a few minutes of Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Okay, so we will, even the chanting is very effective if it is done in the subtle way, in your mind rather than loudly. So what we'll do is we'll do this transition. Okay. Few times we'll chant loudly, a few times we'll chant very softly like whispering, and then a few times we'll chant just in our mind and see how different things would be, how impactful it would be. Okay? So let's sit comfortably. Keep your back straight, shoulders relaxed. Om Namo Bhagavate वासुदेवाय ॐ नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय ॐ नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय भगवते वासुदेवाय ॐ नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय ॐ नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय भगवते वासुदेवाय ॐ नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय ॐ नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय भगवते वासुदेवाय ॐ नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय ॐ नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय Vasudevaya. जय गुरुदेव। सो लास्ट टाइम वी सॉ दैट द एग्जिस्टेंस हैज थ्री एस्पेक्ट्स, द ब्रह्मन, देयर इज पुरुष एंड द प्रकृति, एंड वॉट परमिएट्स ऑल दिस इज प्राण, द एनर्जी। ब्रह्मन इज प्योर प्राण, जस्ट एनर्जी, एंड द पार्ट ऑफ ब्रह्मन विथ अ डिजायर टू मैनिफेस्ट बिकम्स पुरुष, एंड वेन इट मैनिफेस्ट्स इट बिकम्स प्रकृति, एंड प्रकृति हैज नेम एंड फॉर्म एंड इज डिराइव्ड फ्रॉम द फाइव एलिमेंट्स। लेटर ऑन वी विल सी हाउ इट इज ऑल्सो सब्जेक्ट टू द थ्री गुणास। सो एज द लेवल ऑफ योर प्राणा इंक्रीजेस, योर एबिलिटी टू कनेक्ट टू द पुरुष एंड द ब्रह्मन ऑल्सो इंक्रीजेस। अदरवाइज वी गेट स्टक विद द प्रकृति बिट ऑफ लाइफ। सो इग्नोरेंस इज वॉट, थिंकिंग दैट प्रकृति इज द only reality of life, only the name and form that we see around is the only reality. It is wisdom when you realize that my existence is beyond this limited body, this limited identity which I have. So the whole spiritual practices are the only aim is to bring your level of prana so it automatically comes to you. सो लाइक द चैंट वी से वॉट, न हि ज्ञानेन सदृशं पवित्रमिह विद्यते तत्स्वयं योग संसिद्धिं कालेन आत्मानि विन्दति। नो नॉलेज कैन बी गिवन टू यू फ्रॉम आउटसाइड, इट हैज़ टू कम आउट ऑफ यू, बट वॉट वी कैन डू इज क्रिएट ए एनविरॉन्मेंट वेर यू आर एबल टू प्रोजेक्ट द नॉलेज आउट ऑफ यू, एंड दैट इज द स्पिरिचुअल प्रोसेस, इज टू एलिवेट युअर प्राणा सो दैट यू आर एस्टैब्लिश्ड इन योग एंड द नॉलेज कम्स आउट ऑफ यू at its time. Okay. Now, the context was that Krishna is asking Arjuna to fight, and Arjuna is telling that, no, I cannot fight. This is adharma. This is not right. And also gives a lot of reasons why he should not fight. And one of the reasons he says is, by doing this, I will be bringing a bad name to our entire lineage. Now Krishna has to give him some solutions. Krishna says, look, first he taunts him. He says, I thought you were a great archer, but you are behaving like a coward. Okay, so wake up the valor in you. You are the best archer in the world, they say. So what do talented people need? What do they like? If you are really talented, what is it that you look forward to? A platform. You need a platform where you can display your talent, where you can show that, you know what, I can sing well, I can cook well, I can dance well. Krishna is saying, this is the platform for you. You can show the world what a great archer you are. And if you are intelligent, you will grab this opportunity and just show it. And then what are you worried about? You are worried about getting a bad name? Think of all those people who are now backing you. There are so many people who are actually more closer to Kauravas in relation, but they are now behind you because they think you are doing the right thing. You will be letting all of them down. And what will the enemies think of you? They will think, what, he is such a coward. They will laugh at you. And this will laughter will continue for generations. They will say, once there was a person called Arjuna, you become like a Uttara Kumara. Yeah? So he says, what, by doing what I say, you will not be getting bad name, by doing what you want to do, you will get a much worse name to you and to your lineage. So just listen to me. See, there are two ways you can handle challenges in life. One is the path of knowledge, other is the path of action. The path of knowledge is realizing that your existence is much bigger than the body. Just by cutting off somebody's head or hand or feet, you are not going to take away the life out of them. the soul decides when to come in and go out of the body. So knowing the reality of existence, then you will feel that you are doing nothing. The second thing is knowing that the body is determined by the three gunas and the actions are all stimulated by the gunas. You have got nothing to say in that. So when you look at that, then you will see that I am not doing anything wrong. So this we will talk about in the next session much more detail. And then there is a path of action. What is the path of action? The path of action is one which will free you from the impact of action, which is called karma. Usually whenever you act, you generate more impulses which create more actions. That's how you get bound to the world. But to want to be free, you have to engage in actions which do not bind you to the world, and that is yajna, dana and tapa, and that also he will explain. But then he says, before you get into any of these paths, there is something more important. What is it? Is that you need to have a certain level of energy in you to have a clarity of your intellect, to see this is like this. Otherwise, we will always see things in a very colored fashion, in a biased way. If you look at it, most of our intellect is biased, isn't it? We always have a prejudgment about everything. We are very rarely open about things. Have you noticed this? Everything we have a judgment, this is how it is. We go with this notion and then try to reinforce that understanding. Even if the evidence is opposite to it, we try to look at it in a way so that it suits our belief. Do you see this? So, this is a biased intellect. When you have a biased intellect, you will not be able to perceive reality. You will only perceive falsehood. And because of that only, we think all that we are stuck to in life is the only reality. Why we are not able to get around these things, why we are not able to let go of things in life, is because we think, oh, this is so important. What is so important that you are not giving any importance? But what is really not so important, you are holding it as very important. That's because of intellect, there is no clarity. So he says, to get a clarity in the intellect, you need to elevate your energy to a particular level. And to elevate the energy to a particular level, you first have to become a yogi. So, first I will tell you who a yogi is, how to become a yogi. You become a yogi first and then these things will make a difference, how to deal with it. So, we were all born yogis, but slowly, slowly we became ayogis. When we were born, we were resting in all these 8 units of prana, we were holding on to it. And that prana would keep us elevated, keep us in bliss, keep us in joy. We didn't need anything. Have you ever seen the food you give to children? Absolutely tasteless. Say a baby, 6-month-old, 3-month-old baby. Mother's milk is tasteless. The food which you give to the child initially is tasteless, but the child is happy with it. Yeah? All that a baby needs is some food when it is hungry, some warmth when it is cold, a place to sleep when it is tired. Anything else does it need? It only makes a bit of a trouble when these things are not looked into. When you don't give it food, when it is sleepy and when it is not very comfortable physically. It does not want a palace, does not want a holiday, does not want gold, does not want anything. It is blissed out because it knows what I need to be happy is with me. But as the child grows, it starts looking at things. First it looks at things around, oh, that is there, that is there, that is there. Then you start giving it a bit of a sugar, a bit of a honey, a bit of a sweet, a bit of a salt, a bit of a spice. Then it says, oh, this is also there, that is also there. I like this better, I don't like that better. And slowly, 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 you make it like you. Yeah? That which was happy in its own company, you make it very clingy. Oh, I want this. If the toy is not there, my world is gone. If the chocolate is not there, my world is gone. If my mother is not there, my world is gone. So then you become an independent life into an ignorant life. What is happening here? As the mind starts going more and more outer into the world, to perceive and to engage in the world, it starts losing the energy which it has got. Say for example, you go and watch a movie for 3 hours, you know how much prana you lose? So much prana drains out. That's why when you come out of a movie theater, you don't feel very fresh and energetic, isn't it? Or you listen to music, very nice music. How long can you listen with your headphones? Half an hour, then you will say, I need a break. Why? Because the energy has gone down a bit. You need to recharge yourself to be able to listen. Even you may listen afterwards, but you won't be appreciating it. It will be like a background music. You know, in some houses, television is always on. Nobody is watching it. But it should be there like a background music. Otherwise, you feel uncomfortable. And taste. Well, even if you like something very much, how much can you eat? You know, if you like something very much, it is given to you, the first bite is the best taste you get. Even the second bite, your joy has reduced already. Have you noticed? And by the time you finish it, you are just eating it. Are you getting what I am saying? So, for your senses to be active, they need energy. And when you engage in the senses, engage in the world through the senses, that is the only way you engage in the world is through your senses. When you engage, what happens? The energy starts draining. As the energy starts draining, your ability to enjoy comes down. But because of that habit and desire to enjoy, you continue even though you are not enjoying, hoping that you will get joy. But what it does, it only tires you more. Are you getting what I am saying? Isn't this all our experience? Yes, the ability to enjoy has gone away, but the desire is still there. So we continue even though we are tired and we are not enjoying it. And then what happens? Because you are now slowly moved away from your own self, which is the source of joy, and assume that the joy is there outside, you lose clarity of intellect. And that is where all the attachments happen in life. All our attachments are to the sensory pleasures. What is joy for most people? Something nice to see, something nice to touch, something nice to taste, something nice to smell and listen, isn't it? What else is your experience of joy? For most people, that is the only joy. That is why there is so much attraction towards the senses. Oh, my life is so stressful. The only relief for me is my sensory pleasure. And the sensory pleasures, they no doubt give you joy. But what they do, they also drain you. The purpose of the senses is to give you a glimpse of that infinite joy that is actually in you. But you think that is the only source of joy, just like you think Prakriti is the only existence. The purpose of the senses is to give you a glimpse and help you take you back to the source from where the joy. You know, last time we were discussing that when you have a peak sensory experience, you close yourself, you become antarmukhi. Yeah? When you listen to nice music, you automatically close your ears, close your eyes and say, ah. When you eat something nice, ah. When you smell something nice, you see automatically you try to connect to the source from where you are enjoying. And this technology is meditation. You go back to the source and stay there. And then you will see that this joy is coming from there, it is not coming from there. The sensory object is only a mirror for the joy which is actually emerging from you. And to do this, you need a practice, and this discipline is yoga, and the person who practices this discipline is called a yogi. Are you getting what I am saying? So, the first criteria for you to be in knowledge is you have to become a yogi. Develop a discipline. We are talking this morning, convenience or commitment. Follow your feelings or follow your commitment. Following your commitment is being disciplined. Do you see? If you look at the Ashtavakra Gita, when Janaka asks him, how do I become free? How do I get knowledge? The first sentence Ashtavakra says, you know what? Vishaya sukham vishavat parityajya. He says, your sensory pleasures are the poison of your life. And until you let go of them, you will not get any knowledge. You will only be bound and bound, you will never become free. See, if you have diabetes and the doctor says sugar is poison for you, you will leave it, don't you? You will say, no, I should not take it. Or if you have poorly controlled blood pressure and they say you should not take salt, you will eat bland food. In the same way, when your everything is working well, when you are able to say, this is okay, I am able to be without it, I am able to be without it. That is being disciplined, that is being a yogi. And a yogi does not mean being living a very dull and dry life. No. The senses are there for you to enjoy. The world is there for you to enjoy. God has created it for you to enjoy only. But there is a difference between enjoying and indulging. When you indulge in it, you think the joy is there. And if it is not there, there is no joy for me. Engaging is, it is there, let me enjoy it when it is there. That's all. Okay? You go to somebody's house, they make a cup of tea and you say, okay, they have made it, you drink it. You feel like drinking, you drink it, that's it. But you should not go to their house asking for tea. I came last time, you made a tea which was very nice, can I have some tea today? So that is indulging. Do you see? Somebody gives you some sweet, somebody gives something nice to eat, have it, enjoy it, finish it, kalas there, that is over there. Should not go back and say, I should ask them the recipe, how they made it. Do you see? So, all the things which you do in life, they are not relevant at all what you do. From where you do those things, that is relevant. Okay? If you get up in the morning and you feel, today I have not had my tea, I have got a headache now, then that is a headache. That is really a bondage. But if you don't even remember you didn't have tea this morning, that is fine. When somebody brings you tea, drink it, so what? If you feel like, or you say, no, I've had it in the morning, or I don't feel like drinking it. That means you got a choice and you got freedom as well. Most people cover this choice saying that, no, I can choose to drink or not. The same thing with children. You know, you got responsibility for your children, but have you got the responsibility, have you got the choice to be free from that responsibility, then that is a choice. You say, I look after my children, I do this, I do that. Okay, for 1 week, don't do any of that. Can you stay? If you can stay, then you have got a freedom. If you say, no, I can't stay without doing all this, then that is a bondage. So, you can't hide it under the cover of responsibility. You be responsible, do things. At the same time, you should be able to say that, even if this stops tomorrow, I'm fine. So, yogi is somebody who is able to switch off. Last time we saw, there is a grihastha or a sansari who is so deeply entrenched in the world. For him, getting free from the world is difficult. Say, for example, if you say, got an advanced course from this next month, suddenly you will think, okay, whether I will get a leave from this office, whether I will be able to arrange the finances, whether I will be able to arrange some child care to my children, whether I will be able to do this. What is happening? You are so stuck in the world, you can't come out of it. So this is the nature of a grihastha. Of a sansari means the samsara has caught you so strongly that you feel you have to do so many things to be free. On the other hand, you have got sannyasi. For him, the world is immaterial. He is happy with being unsettled. A sansari, you want to be settled, isn't it? You want settlement, you don't want uncertainty in life. You want a job where there is security. You want a wife who does not run away from you. You want children who listen to you. So, you want settled life. Everything should be predictable for you. You want to buy a house and live there. But for a sannyasi, he moves from this place to that place. He eats in this house and that house. He sleeps here, he sleeps there. For him, unsettledness is a nature for him. You see, that is okay. Because for him, this whole world is like a maya, is like a maze. You think that is fine. For him, he is more focused on the self. Now, yogi is somebody who is in between, who is balanced. He lives in the world, but he is able to switch off at will. If he says that is too much, then he says, yes, that's it, enough. There is nice food, and if he has already had a meal half an hour ago, he says, even if it is nice, I just had half an hour ago, that's it, enough. He should be able to say no. But at the same time, if he is hungry, he should be able to go and eat it, enjoy it, not saying, no, I am a sannyasi, I am not allowed to eat this food. That is not like that as well. So, being a yogi is much higher, because you are not living in the extremes, you are living a balanced in the middle. You can be here, you can go there also. But that freedom you should inculcate. That can only come through discipline. And discipline is a practice. Unless you do it again and again, unless you are able to fast once every 15 days or once every month, you will not be able to do it on a regular basis. You need to say, okay, every Ekadashi I will fast. Initially you can start saying, I will only eat fruits today. And if you do it for 4 or 5 months and are able to eat only, then you will say, this time only take water. And then you can say, I will not take water also. So, this is a practice. You are inculcating a discipline in you to move from your indulgence to your discipline. And that only happens through your self-effort, through your intention. Nobody can bring that in. An environment can be created for you to do that, but you have to do it yourself. So, the first step is what? Being a yogi. A yogi is a balanced person, a balanced personality who lives in the world but still is not touched by the world. He is not bound by the world. He enjoys the world, but the world does not dictate him. He enjoys the senses, but the senses don't dictate him that what he should be eating, what he should be doing. He says, if I like, I will do it. If I don't like, I won't do it. That amount of strength a yogi will have. Okay? Now, we look at a few shlokas where he describes what a yogi is. And then we will look at it a bit more deeper. Okay.
Yada samharate chayam kurmangi vasarvashah indriyan indriyartebhya tasya prajna pratishthita.
Now he defines a yogi and says, a yogi is one whose intellect is steady, is also called sthita prajna. Prajna means awareness. Usually when you are engaged in the world, your awareness is fleeting. Have you seen? When you are looking at things, are you looking at only one thing? Your eyes are open, you see this, and then you see that, then you see that, then you see this. And the same way your thoughts keep jumping. So, when you are engaged in the world, your awareness is not steady. Your awareness keeps fleeting from one thing to another. Why? Because the nature is diverse. There is diversity in nature. And suddenly you feel, you see this and say, oh, that may be better. Oh, that may be better. Oh, that may be better. You keep on jumping, seeking joy. But when you come to the self has no color, no shape, no form. It is just a presence. There is nothing to jump from one to another. The moment you withdraw from the world and establish your awareness in the self, then that waveringness stops. So, just like a tortoise withdraws its limbs into its shell, in the same way when you withdraw from the sensory objects into yourself and stay there from the indriya and indriyartebhya. The senses which are moving towards the sense objects, when you can withdraw them like a tortoise withdraws into its shell and establish in yourself, in the self, the Purusha which is not changing, then you are said to be a sthita prajna. Then you are said to be a focused person.
Tani sarvani samyamya yukta sita matpara vasehi yasyendriyani tasya prajna pratishthita.
Again says the same thing. The very reason why you can't focus on yourself is because you are so focused outside. Because your focus is outside, you are not able to bring it back. Only when you are able to withdraw from your senses, you are able to focus on me. Matpara. Focus on me. You are able to focus on me or your own self only when you are able to withdraw from the senses. And when you do that again, what you are called? You are called a sthita prajna, one whose awareness is established.
Raga dvesha vimuktaistu vishayan indriyaischaran atma vashyair vidheyatma prasadam adhigachati.
Now, this is very interesting and very important. First he says, see, he gives such a logical explanation. First he says, you need to have energy to appreciate life. Then he says, where is your energy is being lost? Through your sensory pleasures, your indulgence in the sensory pleasures. And your worry and your stress. These three things are taking away your energy. And your stress and worry is all about gaining or losing something in the prakriti. Isn't it? All your stress and worry is about what? Some name and form. So, your senses and your indulgence in the world is what is draining you. And then he says, only when you are able to withdraw, you are able to conserve your energy. Otherwise, it is like, you know, you put a bucket in the well and when it is in the water, it appears full. But you have got 5 or 6 holes in it. The moment you start pulling out, everything drains out. That's how the life will become. So you get energy when you sleep, when you meditate, but then you drain it all off before you are able to enjoy that as much as you should. So, first learn to withdraw. And when you withdraw, what happens? You are able to focus on the self which is non-changing, the Purusha. We did this witnessing on the last class, isn't it? How when you focus intensely on the action becomes less important and the actor becomes important. Yeah, this is withdrawing from the world. When you do something with full awareness, say for example, we did this chanting in your mind. Did you notice when you do the chanting in your mind, automatically your focus goes on the person who is chanting rather than the chanting? Did any of you notice that? Yeah. So, when you make something very, very with too much awareness, the action becomes less important and the actor becomes important. Okay. So, when you are only able to withdraw from the senses, you will be able to establish in the self. And now he says, what happens when you establish in the self? He says, the world is full of opposites. The world is in duality. The moment you are in the world, opposites take over you. Good, bad, craving, aversion, right, wrong, pleasure, pain. All these are nature of the world. The moment you engage with the world, you take one of the positions and say, I like it or I don't like it. This is nice, this is not nice. This is good, this is boring. You see, dualities come in. But when you are able to withdraw, what happens? The duality cease. Raga dvesha vimuktaistu. You become free from the duality. The biggest duality which causes problem for us is what? Craving, aversion. You crave for pleasure. You are averse to unpleasantness in life. Pleasure and pain are just intense sensations. Have you noticed this? Both are intense sensations. One you like it, one you don't like it. So, what happens when you like one thing? You try to grab as much as you can from it. But if you look at it properly, both pleasure and pain are given to you in equal dosages. What is this much you want, this much you try to grab, it is not there, you feel discontented. What is this much you think this is so much and you try to run away from it and then it really appears this much. So, he says this is the problem. The problem is not in the world, the problem is in your interpretation, is in your craving and aversion. And unless you withdraw from the world, then you won't be able to be free from craving and aversion. And when you are able to be free from craving and aversions, what happens? Prasadam adigachati. Grace comes into your life. Very interesting. Life becomes a blessing. Prasadam adigachati. See, this is such a beautiful word, prasada. I don't think there is a proper translation in English for prasada. You can say blessing, you can say grace. See, your life becomes a prasada. Means what? It becomes a blessing, a benediction. Because why? Because you are okay with both. You see pleasantness and you say, this will also go away. You see unpleasantness and say, this will also not stay for long. Does anything stay forever in life? Nothing stays forever. Pleasure or pain, they come, they go. They come, they go. And when you have got this steadiness or clarity of the intellect to stand back and say, yes, the pleasure has come so many times in my life, it has gone. pain also has come, it has gone. They will come and they will go. You get health, there is sickness. You get headache sometimes, you feel energetic sometimes. You feel hungry, you feel full. The opposites are part of the world. So when I am engaged in the world, opposites are anyway there, they are anyway complementary. If you think like that and see what happens, there is no craving and aversion. Then life becomes a prasada, a grace. A grace means what? You are able to accept life in its totality. You are not running away from something, or you are not running behind something also. You are where you are. What comes to life, you go through it with the same level of equanimity. And that is called prasada. Is when you say everything is fine. You know, there was this Sufi saint, and he with his followers, he was going from one village to another village. In one village, when they went, there was the chieftain's daughter's wedding was happening. So they invited these people, they gave them a royal feast, they gave them all gifts, and they were all very happy. These are literally like fakirs, you know, they are not got anything. Whatever people give is what they get. And that day they had a fantastic meal, they got some takeaway bags as well, and then they had everything, they had gifts, everything. They felt very happy, and then they sang and danced in the party. And then they walked, and the next day it was very hot, and they walked to another village, and there they didn't get a single drop of water to drink. Again in the evening when the sun set, this saint started dancing again. And the disciples asked, what is wrong with you? You know, yesterday you danced, that is, we can understand. Why are you dancing? We are so struggling here, we are so tired, we have walked such a long time. He said, yesterday God gave me a chance to feast. Today has given me a chance to fast. You see, this is how a yogi is. So what? Tomorrow again another feast will come. It does not matter. Not running behind a feast or not running away from a fast, that is the quality of a yogi. And when that happens, life appears a blessing. So in every difficult situation, you see a silver lining. You know what? If this was not there, I would never have fasted. Do you see this? So this is being a yogi. Prasadam adigachati. And for to get grace in your life, you need to get above the dualities of life. Likes and dislikes, cravings and aversions. That can only happen when prana is high. The prana, easiest way to accumulate your prana is to stop overindulging in your pleasures of the world.
Prasade sarva dukkhanam hanir asyopajayate prasanna cheta sohyashu buddhih paryaya tishtate.
Again he says the same thing. When grace enters your life, all the small little problems people are moaning about, they appear irrelevant to you. Hani rasyopa jayate, all they get destroyed. The material problems which people are talking about, worried about so much, they just evaporate from your life. Hani rasyopa jayate. The moment grace enters your life, everything disappears. All the so-called problems, they don't carry any significance to you. And then what happens? Prasanna chetaso hyashu. You become a pleasant person. You carry the pleasantness within you. And once that pleasantness happens, buddhi paryaya tishtate. Your intellect stands separate from the intellect of the crowd. The crowd is all saying, oh, run there, and you are saying, I'm here. This is fine. Your intellect stands apart from the rest of the crowded intellect when you are able to see that life is a benediction. When you are able to see that what I want is all here. I need a little bit of discipline to understand and appreciate this.
Yanisha sarva bhutanam tasyam jagarti samyami yasyam jagrati bhutani sanisha pashyato munihi.
Says, what is night for the worldly person, that is day for a yogi. So this is a metaphorical representation. So a yogi is like an off-peak person. When everybody is going out on a Friday, Thursday evening, he goes out on a Friday morning because it is less crowded. Friday, Thursday evening, traffic very heavy, don't want to go anywhere. So when the whole world is running on Thursday evening, he sleeps, and on Friday morning he wakes up and goes. The road is all clear. So what is night for the worldly person is day. When everybody is sleeping on Friday morning, he is traveling. And when everybody is traveling, he is sleeping. Jagrati samyami. Samyami is what? One who has had a say over the senses, he is awake when the world is asleep. The what is the world asleep? The world is asleep to the reality of its own existence and is running behind falsity. So the yogi sees that and he stops running there. And when the world wakes up and starts running behind things, he rests, knowing that there is no joy there. It is only a hope of joy. It is only a mirage. So he rests. And when everybody is resting, when everybody is looking in the other direction, he walks in the right direction. So if you go to Kashi, have you been to Kashi, any of you? Okay, so if you go to Kashi, you know, on the ghats, you will see some of these agoris sitting with the black dress. Have you seen them? Yeah. If you observe them, they just sit in one place. You don't even see them get up and go for restroom, or don't even see them go and cook food, or it will just be sitting there. You go at 9 o'clock, they are sitting. You go in the afternoon, they are sitting. You go at 8 o'clock for the aarti, they are also there sitting. But you go at 3 o'clock in the morning, they won't be there. So that's when they do all their sadhana. They go have a cold water bath in the Ganga. They do all their sadhana for 3-4 hours. And by the time you wake up and come there, they are back into their place sitting there. So when everybody is sleeping, they know it is easy to get their job done. They do all their things, washing their clothes, cooking their food, doing their sadhana, because there is nobody to distract and disturb you. The world distracts us. By ourselves, if we leave, we don't want much. But we go to these get-togethers, we go to these parties, and then you see, oh, that dress looks nice. That jewelry, where did it come from? That movie they went, we should also go. That holiday they said was very nice. You know, the world distracts you. Your desires are not even your desires. You have carried somebody else's desires. And you think, my desire is not fulfilled. This is what the world does to you. And the yogi is very clever. He says, let me not even go there. Only when I go there, I get all these things. So let them do what they want. And when they are all gone, not to distract me, I will do my stuff. Do you see this? Yeah. So this is the importance of a yogi, is what? When everybody is running in one direction, he looks at the exact opposite direction, which is actually the real direction where everybody should be walking. And everybody is resting, he is awake. So this is being a yogi. Being a yogi is being able to live with yourself, being different. When you become a yogi, in the initial stages, you feel you are a misfit in the society. So sometimes you feel, you know what, am I doing something right? Because nobody is doing what I am doing. But then you don't see that everybody is stressed and worried. Nobody is in bliss doing what they are doing. Everybody is doing things because they see everybody else doing it. That's why. They are not analyzing why we are all doing this. And then you do something and you feel good about it, then you also start doubting. Is this right or not? You know, am I doing something correct or not? I don't know how long this will last. So whenever something positive happens, what happens? You doubt the positive. When negative happens, you happily embrace it. It is happening to everybody, so it should be normal. Stress is normal. See, ask, everybody has got stress, so it is normal. See, 20 years ago, nobody spoke about stress. I don't remember my parents speaking about stress when they were growing up. Now, everybody says stress. The children say stress. I don't remember being stressed. Probably during your exams a few times. The stress was not the exam. Stress was getting hit by the parents more than anything else. Okay, not able to go out and play, not able to watch television. That was stress rather than actually studying. But now, everybody talks about stress. Do you see this? and we are not awakened to this principle that what is happening, whole lifestyle has changed and we are not even aware. Why? Because we think, oh, everybody is stressed, so it should be normal. Isn't it? When you do something which, when somebody says, I'm really happy, people doubt them. You know, maybe he's crazy a bit. You know, maybe something is loose. That is why he says he's really happy. How can he be not stressed? Or maybe he's lying. Maybe he's showing off. Do you see this? So, the conditioning of unhappiness is so strong in our life, we think that is the normal way of living. That is why you need to have a guru in your life. Because a guru says, look, I am born like you. I eat the same food like you. I walk the same earth. I breathe the same air. I deal with people day in, day out. And see, nothing touches me. I am able to be untouched. And you can be like me. Just a living example. To see, it is possible for you also. If I can do it, you can also do it. That's why, you know, in the advanced course you see that asangoham punah punaha punah punaha. Again and again I am here to remind you that nothing in the world will touch you. Your pure existence of Brahman and Purusha cannot be tainted at all. You are untouched by anything. And I am here again, he says punah punaha punah punaha. I am here to remind you again and again. Nothing can touch you. You are shuddha nitya shuddha vimuktoham. You are pure, you are clean, and you are free. And once again, I am showing you by my living example that it is possible for you also. Just come and surrender to me and do what I tell you to do, and then you will get there. Asangoham punah 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 sachidananda rupoham. So this is understanding truth. So that is the first step, being a yogi. Commitment above convenience. So when you say, my commitment is important, be comfortable in life. See, there is this what is called wrong vairagya. We see a lot of places in the world. Somebody says, you know, they tie a truck to their teeth and they pull the tire. What is the point of doing all those things? Those siddhis are useless. Do some simple things. Have a say over your senses. Have a bit of discipline in your eating habits. Be more regular with your sadhana. Keep company which will uplift you, rather than company which will make your desires more. Yeah, if you go somewhere and come back, you feel, ah, so nice I went, I feel so good about it. You should not come back and start fighting with your husband or wife. Look, they have got this, you have not got me this. You see this, look how they are looking after. All these things should not happen. That is a bad company. A company which pulls you down, which makes you feel you lack something in life, is a bad company. A company which says, look, you have got so much in life, why don't we use this, is good company. So give a bit of attention to your company, bit of attention to your food, and bit of attention on yourself, and then you will see your life take such a dramatic turn. Your health improves, your relationships improves, you are so light-witted in life, you feel so light in life, nothing will bother you. Things happen, there is, everybody has got challenges. As I said, look at Krishna's life, look at Rama's life. You really can't live their life, you will be crushed in a day. It was so difficult, but because of their, what they say, their knowledge, their ability to be in knowledge, they were able to just move through that quite easily. You know, that is what dispassion brings. You know, later on he says, how when you get in knowledge, viveka dawns in you, and viveka dawns in you, vairagya comes. And when vairagya comes, you say, so what? You know, nothing will shake you. You will become unshakable. You know this World Culture Festival which happened 4 or 5 years ago? It was a brilliant event. So I was there in the ashram about 2-3 days before the actual event, okay? And there was a lot of tension among the people, because they had created a village in the ashram. There were 50,000 participants, but they were practicing day in, day out. Everybody was geared up. And that was the day when we got the news that the president is not coming. And there was a doubt whether the prime minister will be coming also. All these things were happening. So there was a bit of a tension in the ashram. No? And there were lots of people, and then satsang started, And Guruji came just like any other day, full bindas, very cool, making jokes, sitting, and regular satsang. And then we could feel that there is a tension, and nobody was asking the question. Now what is going to happen, sort of a thing. And then Guruji said, "Are mast raho, everything will happen. Why are you worried? You know, where there is sattva, there is satya. And satyam eva jayate, there is nothing that can beat the truth." Okay. If the worst thing happens and they say, they are not going to allow us to do there, we got the whole street to the India gate, we'll display there and we'll come back. So what? Don't worry. That is the strength of dispassion. That was such a big event on the world stage. So many people, so much investment, so much reputation at stake. Okay? Imagine if you are just hosting a party in our house, how stressed we become. And imagine hosting such a big event and saying, so what, if it does not happen, does not happen, let's go. That is the strength that comes with dispassion. And that comes when you are steeped in knowledge and see, the world is full of opposite, keeps moving this way, that way. Don't worry. Not being able to be distracted. Sometimes you will see in satsangs, especially in the ashram, in the advanced course are happening, some satsangs are very loud and people are in such josh. It is such loud, like party like satsang, and you will see Guruji just gone. You know, he will be like this for 20, 30, 40 minutes as if nothing is happening around. That is the strength of dispassion, where nothing can shake you. Where you know that when I want to switch off, nobody can make me switch on. And when I am switched on, I am fully there. And that's why it is such a privilege to have a guru in our life. Because guru is an example, a live wire you can see and just do it. Okay? That much enough for today. Okay? Jai Gurudev. Jai.